Distinguished members of Henri Dunant Foundation, dear professors and teaching assistants of the Geneva Academy, dear colleagues and friends. It's a great honor for me to receive the Henri Dunant Prize in Research, not only because it's a privilege to know that my work was appreciated by the jury members, but also because I owe a lot both personally and professionally to the International Committee of the Red Cross that has been created due to the efforts of Henri Dunant and where I spent three fantastic years of my life before coming to the Geneva Academy. The topic of my LLM paper was dedicated to a very specific subject, which is the right to life of state's own military personnel in the context of hostilities. I came up with this idea being inspired by Professor Gaggioli and Professor Sassoli, who have always been insisting on the practical implication of applicable norms and complementarity between IHL and human rights. When working with the ICRC, I have clearly understood that human suffering does not have race, religion, gender, or profession. That the world is not black and white, and especially when it comes to an armed conflict. And what is most importantly, that prevention of atrocities is always more efficient than the subsequent persecution. Henri Dunant started his noble mission when he organized relief for the wounded soldiers on the battlefields of Solferino. For more than a century later, we now have a comprehensive legal regime protecting combatants of the combat, prisoners of war, as well as limiting means and methods of warfare in conduct of hostilities. All this is to ensure that the enemy is treated with dignity and humanity, and that no adverse distinction is acceptable in humanitarian action. My idea was to go a little bit further and to see what are the obligations of the states towards its own military. When discussing the human rights of soldiers, the drama is that the starting point of this discussion is never a legal argument, but rather moral considerations. Because at the end of the day, I don't think I will be mistaken if I say that soldiers are seen rather as perpetrators for ones and the heroes for the others. They are rarely considered as the rights beholders and even less as the victims of violations. Neither I will be wrong if I suggest that for many people there is no such a thing as the right to life for soldiers. They do go to the battlefields knowing that they will probably never come back. They do sacrifice their lives for their motherland. However, this by no means should relieve the state of its human rights obligations that it owes to its own nationals. In the first part of my paper, I analyzed the international and domestic human rights jurisprudence to demonstrate that, firstly, the state does have specific obligations under the right to life towards its own army. I came to the conclusion that the state has specific obligations to protect the life of its soldiers both in peacetime and in armed conflicts. And that proper training and equipment of servicemen is the core of these obligations. The main idea was not to create an unrealistic burden for the state, but to show that only some obligations can be interpreted in the light of particularities of the military service. While the others, such as, for example, the obligation to investigate suspicious deaths or alleged violations of the right to life, has no contextual interpretation. In the second part of my paper, I turned on to the IHL norms to see whether this protective human rights discourse can actually coexist with the pragmatic rules of armed conflicts. Coming back to the cardinal principle of humanity and the Martin's Clause, I try to demonstrate that the protection of state's own army is not foreign to IHL, and that the respect for humanity and human dignity does not have any nationality test. Then I showed that the protection of the life of combatants is part and parcel of contemporary IHL, and that it is inherent in the principle of military necessity and the norms limiting the means and methods of warfare. However, here I identify the legal gap in protection. The norms governing the conduct of hostilities focus only on the protection of the enemy, and they stay silent when it comes to the protection of the state's own armed forces. This is where the human rights should come into play. The most intriguing part was the practical implications of such further humanization of armed conflicts. My principal goal was to show that there is a direct dependence between protection of human rights of the military and their subsequent behavior in the battlefield. At the same time, IHL is well equipped to prevent possible misuse of human rights arguments by states. Thus, I came to the conclusion that including compulsory human rights component in the military training would enhance general compliance with IHL and human rights in armed conflicts. The soldiers who are well trained and equipped and know that their state protects their right to life will be more likely to have mercy for the enemy and respect the law. And I would like to finish by expressing my sincere gratitude to all the professors and teaching assistants of the Geneva Academy, and in particular to Professor Gaggioli for being a tremendously supportive and encouraging supervisor for my LLM paper, helping me to navigate in this very complex topic. I would also like to thank Professor Sassoli, whose IHL classes have always been intellectually challenging and extremely inspiring. My family, who despite this very difficult and surreal year, has always been the greatest support I could ever ask for. And finally, to people I love, and to my friends in Geneva and abroad, and especially to Berta, Melina, Serhat, Fabrizio and Juan, without whom this year would have never been so special. And congratulations to all of us, even in global pandemics we made it.